Mr. President, may I echo Robin in saying what a privilege and pleasure it is for us to have you here. I know how busy you are while you're in London. There's a cricketing expression called a googly, which is when a ball is bowled at you, and which you weren't expecting, and you just bowled one at me because
you've you've done that repeatedly to me, so what's new?
which is that you're not going to make a prepared remarks. We were going to have a conversation. And what I'm going to do is open the floor up after a while, because I know that there are a lot of people bursting to ask you questions. I think the first obvious question to ask you is, when is the next edition of your book coming out? Because you wrote it 8 years ago, and it's very rare to have the author of the manual actually running, you know, managing a state and implementing your own, as it were, your own theories. Have you learnt a lot even since the time that you wrote the book with Claire Lockhart 6 or 7 years ago?
Well, in the name of God, the compassionate, the merciful, first of all, thank you for having me. I was so looking forward to Chatham House rule being applied in Chatham House. But of course, I'd love a public conversation. And thank you for those kind words. But yes, because learning is a continuous process. So let me just make a couple of framing questions. First thing I've learned is how to create political capital. What the technical discussions ignore is fundamentally that all processes of state formation are political and moral. You need a moral campus in order to put the country above yourself. And that means you have to generate political capital, not political division. The act that my colleague and friend Dr. Abdullah, our VPs, our old friends, were able to take in Afghanistan required both moral courage and determination and a sense that divisive politics would lead to denial of opportunities to the absolute majority of the people, and hence, that's the first point. Second is, there's a lot of discussion on political will in the literature, but it's not grounded in anything. So they say, well, you know, they either have political will or they don't. What's the dynamic of creating political will? The first basis of having political will is to have political capital. Because then you calculate how much of it you're willing to use and how will you renew it. This means, going back to one of the critical issues that we put in fixing failed state, is that the purpose of the state, if you still speak in that kind of moral language, is to serve the citizens. I'm a servant. And as servant, I know who my masters are. And my masters are the citizens of Afghanistan. So we need to be able to generate the decisions that allows this dynamic. We've taken hard decisions. It has resulted in temporary depletion of our political capital, but because they were based on well thought through actions, the capital got enhanced. And hence, the other is, you know, governing, unlike academic thinking, is relentless. Time does not wait for you. Had we not confronted the Kabul Bank on the second day, I would not have the political capital to speak to the world or to our people. Had we not taken the decision to approve the bilateral security agreement, sign the bilateral security agreement, and the status of force agreements, we would not have had the consensus. So these are part of the issue. The other is, you know, theory, if it's to be translated to practice, needs focus. And focus means, you know, you have to acknowledge what you inherit. And what you inherit is both dysfunctionality and pockets of excellence, And it requires determination to define what the problem is. In building the process of the state, owning the problem is fundamental to solving it. If we are in denial that we have a problem, we cannot formulate a vision.
You mentioned, I mean, the opinion polls about you in Afghanistan are truly extraordinary. I mean, you must be the most, perhaps, popular person since opinion polls started in Afghanistan, but certainly you're riding very, very high. And you mentioned managing expectations. And yet you face a number of very serious challenges. I mean, economic, security, political, and so on. How can you continue to meet those expectations and manage those expectations? And you talk of, you know, focus, which presumably means priorities as well. I mean, should priorities be set on the basis of popular expectations?
Well, two things. Don't take opinion polls seriously. They will come and they will change. The key is to have a compass. If you don't have a compass and you shift with the winds, you're not going to deliver to the people. I'm not elected to be popular. I'm elected to be effective. People are going to judge me by effectiveness, by delivery. We got the talk right. It's the doing that creates the sense of confidence. But second, the people of Afghanistan have shown enormous wisdom. I bow to that wisdom. Look, 38% of our women participated in the election. Women who had not gotten in the house for 30 years of their lives got into cars with their husbands who had previously would not allow them or their children and went and voted. What do they want? Why did they come out? From the remotest corners of the country, you know, I had no money. I had no official backing, etc. But why did people come out with such massive numbers? Because they want profound change. And it's that sense now. The people, you know, we had to have a notion very common in political science and other places, the silent majority. Well, the Afghans are not silent. We have voice, and the voice is very loud and clear. So things they want are not things for themselves. People want a different life for our children. A profound overcoming of the last 35 years. So my priorities are those of the people. It's the sense of balancing those on a daily basis, on a weekly basis, on a monthly basis that guides me. And I think we will be able to overcome because we have no other choice. Mm-hmm.
I mean, one of the things that, one of the interpretations of the elections was that people were voting against insecurity. They were voting for a right to choose. They were voting for a safer future. And yet, at the moment, we're facing a horrendous, and please accept our commiserations for all violence that is taking place, a horrendous spike in violence in terms of civilian casualties, in terms of police and soldiers who are losing their lives or being injured, in terms of people being displaced, IDPs. What do you think explains this spike in violence? Is it a trend or is it a spike? And you know, at a time when security is the top priority for everyone, how can this be addressed?
Well, first let me put in comparative perspective. Every movement of violence before coming to peace spikes up. Look at every single peace agreement in the world. Prior to reaching peace, there's been an upswing because it is about negotiating space. Mm-hmm. It's about demonstrating relevance. Second, attacks on civilians are a sign of weakness. They're not a sign of strength. Who but a coward kills people in a volleyball field? Children! for God's sake, is that the depth in which we've fallen? You know, we use the Islamic civilization defined to humanity at large. We translated Greeks, we translated the Indians, we translated the Chinese and give them to the world. Now, killing the children in a volleyball field is going to deter me. We need to understand that this is a sign of weakness. It's not a sign of strength. Thirdly, if they feel or anyone else feels that the Afghan state is about to collapse, I have news for you. We've lived 5,000 years. We are going to be there for another 5,000. Don't misjudge us. And this, the other thing is, you know, we're determined. We have a national consensus on peace as our priority. Violence is directed to detract us from the path of peace. We will not be detracted. Political problems must be solved politically. But that segment that is dedicated to violence, for the sake of violence, will be isolated. The water within which they were swimming, the pond is going to be dried. Let us be clear. And our security forces, I want to pay tribute to them. You know, they've done their job. The 150,000 ISAF NATO troops were doing. And against all predictions of 4 years ago, both friends of Afghanistan and detractors of it, We are meeting our security targets. On 31st of December, the combat mission of ISAF NATO will end. Afghans, again, will be in charge of legitimate use of force. All decision makings regarding legitimate use of force is going to be vested in the Afghan government. And this will change the dynamic and the narrative. The narrative was that foreigners are here, foreigners are in occupation, foreigners will never leave. It's over. We have taken charge, and we are an elected government. And besides being elected, we are a government of national unity. And that should count for something.
Mr. President, I think you've lifted the spirits of many Afghans by talking about the priority you give to bringing peace. At the SAARC meeting recently, you talked about just how high a priority this is for you. And you've just said that before peace processes start, there is often a burst in violence. Does this mean that you see a peace process as fairly imminent and that you see a peace process as a fundamental element in bringing that violence to an end?
The peace process is fundamental to bringing it to an end. I'm not going to conduct public diplomacy regarding the peace process. It must be a deliberate process. We intend to deliver. We don't intend to talk about delivery. Give us the space and the time, and you will see the results.
One of the transitions, I know you've just come from a very successful conference in which the formation of the Government of National Unity has been hailed as a terrific opportunity for the country. And you've mentioned the three transitions, the economic transition, the political transition, and the security transition. And I think you were saying that the economic, in a way, is perhaps the most pressing and the most difficult, and where least progress has been made. And that's partly because of the immediate cash flow problem and the long-term structural deficit and so on. How are you going to tackle that? I mean, given the number of priorities and given your well-known commitment to creating jobs and so on, I mean, how are you going to get into that one?
Well, first, the economy got distorted because of the ISAF NATO became the largest economic actor in the country. So the unintended presence of a very large military organization was major economic distortions. It's totally unintended. For instance, the transport sector grew to account for the amazing 20, almost 22% of GDP, because trucking was often for supplies. The construction sector. So every year, the percentage of agriculture in the GDP is declined. Mm-hmm. A lot of cash came, but it did not become capital. So, and also, we have a section of that economy that got heavily criminalized, which is part of global criminal networks. The global criminal economy is $1.7 trillion a year, Davos estimation. And the bulk of the profits from the criminalized drug economy goes to the international mafia. So given all this, when we started the security transition, I wrote a paper because arguing that the economy would face very significant challenges. Unfortunately, our colleagues in the development community did not buy my argument. They were very, very optimistic. And their projections, if you look at it, I argued that the rate of growth could come down to 2% or approach zero, and that's where we've reached.
1.5, I think.
So, 1.5.
Yeah.
Exactly. So, now what do we do? The first issue is market building has been very weak. Mm-hmm. International development community talks about private sector as though it's an organic phenomenon and exists everywhere. Market building is an historical process. UN in Great Britain, you know, the first work, Marshall on Citizenship, was about how freedoms came as a result of removing restrictions on guilt. Civil rights preceded political. We need to look at those problems that the market can solve. There's an immense potential. For instance, 75% of Kabul's residents are estimated to have informal property rights rather than full property rights. Mm-hmm. Now, in 1978, probably not more than 5% was informed. Next year, we intend to begin a massive program of giving full property rights to people in situ.
Right.
And figuring this out, I think we've figured it, is going to be a breakthrough.
Mm-hmm. And this has been tried in Latin America, for
example. It's been tried in Latin America, but on a very small scale.
Yeah.
I think we are going to do it mm-hmm. with a combination of learning from Latin America and others. Mm-hmm. De Soto, my friend, has put the theory. I think with his help and others, can really do it on a scale that would be very significant. The second element is look at Afghanistan's assets. In first blush, everybody wants to talk about our minerals. Mm. I want to reverse the process. We want to first talk about our location. For 200 years, our location has been a disadvantage. In the next 20 years, it's going to become solid gold. All roads between South Asia and Central Asia can only lead through us. We can become the transfer points with East Asia.
The roundabout.
The roundabout. The Asian roundabout. So we are beginning with the first national infrastructure program to connect to. This will generate the capabilities. We've moved from theory to practice Central Asia, South Asia 1000. It's a project that takes electricity from Kyrgyzstan to Tajikistan to Afghanistan to Pakistan. It's been signed into law, into an agreement. And $1.2 billion of financing is already there. We're moving to turn our first major river into a source of generation of electricity in creating the connectivities. Our second asset is water. We have five river basins. Except for China, we provide water to every one of our neighbors. Yet we only use 10% of our water in modern management. We lose 800 million to a billion and a half to floods, and then another one to droughts. Managing our water is critical now. So 20 dams, all from internal rivers, that have not been completed, would be the driver of this. Third is, we have money. But money is not capital, because firm formation has not been attempted. So how you get, it's not private sector and abstraction, it's formation of firms, small, medium, and large. Mm-hmm. We are turning the budget into an instrument. Our budget is 40% of our GDP. but it has not been used to generate economic activities because it's been an abstract relationship between supply and demand. It's these set of connectivities that would end lastly and immediately. We want to go to create one of the most labor-intensive programs after the New Deal, building on those sets of things and combining it with a lot of approaches that we've learned from others so we can tackle the question of jump-starting the economy.
The neighbors of Afghanistan, after 36 years of more or less continuous conflict, must need some persuasion that Afghanistan, as I think as you've put it, is a resource not only for the people of Afghanistan, but also as a resource for them and a place that they can safely invest in. Do you think that it's going to be easy to turn around those anxieties and perceptions and long-held views of Afghanistan as a difficult neighbor rather than one that is a common resource?
Well, there are several aspects to that. First, we're not the only source of danger.
It's true.
And what the last experience has shown now is that our fates are bound. If you look into the state system, states are the constitutive units of the international system. When one state breaks out, or a group of them break out to behave like non-state actors, the entire system weakens. Second, a collapsing state or a failing state exposes the weak point, the soft underbelly of the system. Exposure becomes very wide. We are in one of those moments with Syria, with Iraq, with Libya, with Yemen. So this phenomenon, now the risks can no longer be ignored. You could have had attitudes before that there are good and bad terrorists, their support. It's this common, the dawning of the realization that the threats are common and the response cannot be by a single country. You cannot build a fortress around the state or around the continent. As a result of this, I see a new opening. Second is that the dissolution of the Soviet Union, the takeoff of Central Asia now, is opening up a set of possibilities regarding resources that just previously were not there. We are reconnecting to our remote pasts. Mm-hmm. There's a fantastic book by Fred Starr, let me plug it. It's called Lost Enlightenment. It's about Central Asia from 3rd century before the Common Era to 12th century. Mm-hmm. And it shows how connected the area was, how the connectivities, culturally, economically, and that culture and the economy interplay. So we have very deep structures in Brodel's sense that allow us now to resume. So the story that we are saying of the roundabout is not new. Mm. This, I think, is being realized, and that gives us an opportunity to connect.
You mentioned Syria and Ukraine. And one of the things that's struck me and was reinforced by listening to some of the words at today's conference is just how strong the confluence of international interest is in the success of the government of national unity. You cannot say this about the governments of many other countries that are...
Well, they're governments of national division.
Yes, ours is a government of national unity. And you have also said just a minute ago that it's not by your words that you will be judged, but by what you actually do. And you've come out of the starting blocks at a cracking pace in terms of Kabul Bank and the BSA and so on. But this country has some experience of trying to keep coalition governments together, and it's not easy. What do you think the biggest challenges are going to be in terms of maintaining that unity, given the very difficult decisions that you face ahead?
I think the risks are much less with us. Your strength is that you have institutions. Your weakness is that you have institutions.
Right.
No, because when you've established institutions, it's very difficult to agree on reforms.
So it's about making institutions accountable.
It's making institutions accountable, functional. Both of us, I mean, you know, Dr. Abdullah ran on a program of zero tolerance of corruption.
Yeah.
And that's what we are bringing together. The other is the risks that you outline, the threats that we face, force us to focus on the essential and not on the superficial. So I'm quite optimistic that we can solve the problem. And then let me confront the famous question. There is no Ashraf Ghani temper. I hope it's been shown.
Well, So I'm going to open the floor up in a minute, so I hope everyone will get ready with their questions, and I'm most grateful to you for being willing to take them, and I will feel these questions.
You see, you did so well. Had I given a boring talk, you'd be sitting here.
Well, I'm sure I've forgotten all the right questions. Anyway, but there are some questions that have come in,
sure.
Because your presence was obviously advertised, and some questions have come in. And one is on the importance you attach to China in terms of the success of the government of national unity and in addressing the challenges that you face, both security and economic. So I thought that was a question I might pass to you.
Afghanistan is in the confluence of five intersecting circles. Neighbors, the Islamic world, West, Australia, Japan, Asia, international organizations, international firms. China sits in two of these. China and India are an unprecedented story in human annals of history. 600 million. Hundreds of millions of people have been lifted out of poverty. There's a 400 million Chinese middle class. There's a 90 million Indian middle class. We are in the middle of 3 billion people. Afghanistan's economic growth must, by any way, be oriented towards this market. Mm-hmm. So it just makes immense sense. Two, the Silk Belt project of President Xi Jinping, with whom I had the pleasure of detailed discussion, opens up the neighborhood to the Chinese group. When you look south, none of the countries of South Asia has come out of factor-driven growth, because growth is divided in three phases: factor-driven, efficiency-driven, innovation-driven. None of the countries, including India, it's come out to efficiency-driven. China is efficiency-driven. Singapore is innovation-driven. This allows us the diversification, because the value chains with our mining world and our agriculture and other resources that we do, China is a factor in. Second, China is an immediate neighbor. Very
Just.
Small 90...
Don't ruin the Wakhan corridor, Mr. President. Please.
Don't ruin my economic future. No, look, you know, I mean, people like you, I apologize, people like you for the expression, are so good about preaching to us, but destroying your own environment.
It's true.
Please stop polluting the world and then tell me to preserve the Wakhan corridor. Let's have a country. No, the deal I propose to you, buy some of our sun and give us some of your rain.
Okay, we can probably organize that.
No, I mean, we will preserve it. Rightly, we will, of course, are absolutely keen on preserving the Wuhan corridor, but the connectivity is important, and we need to be able. The pipelines from Turkmenistan and ultimately the Caspian to China are a fundamental story, and we are positioning ourselves in that regard. China also has immense experience in infrastructure. The way, if you look at infrastructure, the next 20 years, 36 to 70 trillion dollars are going to be invested in infrastructure globally. A significant part of this is going to be spent in Asia. We want to get our national infrastructure right, and the Chinese are going to come and help. And then, you know, our mineral wealth requires both, because the transport corridors need to work.
I mean, one of the things you often emphasize is that Afghanistan's greatest asset is its human capital,
yes.
particularly its women.
Yes.
You know, some would argue that the experience of Chinese investment in Africa, for example, has not been as advantageous as it could have been in terms of strengthening human capital, and sometimes it's even marginalized.
But looking at China's investment in Latin America, and it's very productive. We're not going to be an African country because we're going to determine our fate. We don't give anyone the right to determine our economic fate. We determine it. It's a partnership. Mining companies in the West did horrors everywhere in the world. And we are learning from those, so it's neither going to be...
You're not going to repeat the mistakes.
And, you know, look at some of the same companies. Now, they talk of corporate responsibility, but their histories are written in blood and toil.
Yeah.
We want to avoid all of this, because our key goal is citizenship. So it's not which companies come from where. It's under which discipline they will work with us. And we are keen to develop those.
And that goes to the rule of law as well.
It goes to the rule of law, which is absolutely essential.
Yes. Well, let me open the floor up. And if, with your indulgence, I'll take two or three questions.
Of course.
And I see the first hand is...
Should allow me to make my next meeting?
Okay. That's at 9:30, I understand.
No, so it's not.
I recognize...
For once, I have a schedule.
Oh, you do have pieces of paper. I thought you were a paper-free president, Mr. President. Sir William Patey in the front.
Of course. Sir William.
Mr. President, it gives me great pleasure to call you that. Congratulations on your election. Nothing has given me more cause for optimism since I left Afghanistan than your election. Please accept my heartiest congratulations. One of the things I get asked about here when I'm talking about Afghanistan, and I try to continue with my enduring optimism, is the importance of international assistance to Afghanistan to help you achieve your own goals. You've just come from a London conference, which was designed to reinforce their previous commitments. Are you satisfied with the outcome, and are you confident that you'll get the necessary levels of international support over the coming 5 to 10 years to enable you to achieve what you want to achieve?
Well, thank you, Sir William. It's a great pleasure to see you. Thank you for your service, both to your country and to mine. We remember you very fondly. Please come again. I cannot impose on you to become UK's ambassador, but you can become as my friend, always. we remember you very fondly, as your successors and your predecessors. Yes, I'm satisfied about the reaffirmation of commitments. I'm very satisfied about the overwhelming vote of confidence that we've received in both the political course that we've adopted and the course of reforms that we've embarked on. The future depends on our delivery. It's not a one-sided relationship. Let's acknowledge the fundamental fact. The citizens of advanced countries, aid donors, have a fatigue. If 2 years from now, God forbid, Afghanistan ranks at the bottom of Transparency International, there will be no fresh aid. Nobody will have the patience. If we are not effective in delivering on our promises, the amount will not be forthcoming. So we understand, this is why I'm saying we need to own the problem. We, the government, are going to drive reform. And very soon, I think 8 organizations are going to be running after us, saying, we'll give you more, please stop the reform process. No, more seriously. And the second is, aid has not made a single country rich. It's investment in trade. It's getting the the institutions right, that changes. With our poverty, living below $1.25 is 36% of the population. It's remained stubbornly so in the last 8 years. The divide is intolerable. How can you live under $1.25 when some of our citizens spend $2 million on a wedding? And they do. So wealth has to become legitimate. That's our first goal, and I will create. But to repeat, it's a virtuous circle. Reforms, delivery, ensuring that we widen the size of the pie, we increase the value of the proposition regarding Afghanistan. In other words, let me use a bad word, it's a branding issue. Today, our brand has become, our brand was difficult. Today, it's acquired a new luster. We need to burnish this image by continuous delivery. And if you do that, I think aid would come. But more than that, investment, transit, and trade will come. The key to prosperity, Sir William, is not in foreign aid. It's in regional economic integration. And that's what we're focused on.
I recognize Christina Lam.
Oh, hello. Good to see you.
Thank you. Good to see you too. You talked about your very impressive sounding reform program, President Ghani. Isn't it fairly...
Well, what it says impressive sounding, I know what's going to come next.
Well, it made me tired just listening to all the things you were going to do. But isn't it fairly fundamental to have a cabinet before you do that to implement
2 to 4 weeks, and we have announced it, so it will be in 2 to 4 weeks.
Okay. And the second thing I wanted to ask you was, you mentioned Iraq and the difficulties there. We've seen this spike in attacks in Afghanistan in the last couple of weeks. Do you think that the international community is leaving too early, or do you think that they're actually leaving you enough assets and resources to deal with the security situation?
The international community is leaving according to schedule, but the international community is not leaving. We had agreed, I was responsible for heading the security transition. Sir William was there, and other. We're totally on schedule. The Resolute Support Mission was agreed to yesterday in Belgium, in Brussels. We're entering into a new relationship. And this relationship is severalfold. One, there's a commitment to providing financial resources for the Afghan security forces. This has been affirmed. It's also a mission, a non-combat mission of training, advising, and assisting. If you look into our history, the last 13 years are totally unusual. It was we, the Afghans, who provided security to others in the past, not needing. Now the security institutions have been built to sufficient strength to enable us to do our patriotic duty. And just one simple fact. Every member of the army, every member of the police is a volunteer Afghan. No one is compelled to be in the army and in the police. Yes, the casualties are enormously difficult, but our police, when it comes to enforcement of law, may have problems. But we've had incredibly brave policemen who have embraced a suicide bomber, and not one or two, made a notable number, to save the life of others. That speaks to an immense sense of patriotism. And that's what I'm counting on. We will get it right. But of course, there will be skepticism. 4 years ago, a lot of journalists wrote that Afghanistan would collapse today. We've not collapsed, and we're not going to.
Thank you. Now there's a sea of hands. Mr. President, may I take a couple? Because otherwise...
Sure.
So absolutely. Let me take the gentleman in the front row here, and then I'm going to go to the back.
Mr. President, the
Could
question
you kindly
is,
identify yourself?
I'm Jamil Gursel, member of Chatham House. The question I have for you is this. What is the difference between your government now and the previous government, and what are you going to do, something the previous government didn't do, and most importantly, the opium, the heroin, obviously, as you know, the raw materials for it, how are you going to control it, as you are the biggest supplier to the world?
Can I take a question at the back? There's a lady standing at the back with a yellow...
She's a journalist.
Yes, she's Emma Graham-Barrison. I just recognized her, yes.
How can you give journalists the floor? Well,
I'll happily cede to someone else.
No, please do. Please do, by all means. I was just teasing him.
Thank you, Mr. President, and thank you, Mr. Keating. I just wanted to ask, I've just been at the conference where David Cameron, John Kerry were praising the steps you've taken to tackle corruption, particularly the reopening of the prosecution of Kabul Bank. When are we going to see the government holding a senior minister or official to account as the next step in ending the culture of impunity? Because over the last 13 years, there's not been a single senior member of the government prosecuted or otherwise punished for corruption.
Okay, one more question from the back, please. There's a gentleman there with the glasses. Yeah. Could you identify yourself? You're leaving at 1925. I've been...
Okay, hurry up. Good, so thank you.
Lewis McLeod, BBC Monitoring.
Oh, my goodness.
I'd like to ask you...
See? I knew he was like colluding with you.
I'd like to welcome you, first of all,
thank you.
Dr. Ghani, to London and for coming to talk to members of Chatham House. I'd like to ask you a question about the geostrategic position of Afghanistan. And to what extent do you think that the traditional policy of neutrality of Afghanistan has been compromised by signing a bilateral security agreement with NATO and another agreement with the USA, and that this might indeed reduce the voice of Afghanistan in the world,
okay.
Neutrality being a principled and strong position, and you're exchanging it for a weak one.
Okay, so three questions there, narcotics, corruption, and senior official, and I thought that was two questions coming
here. There's two questions here, yes.
So in fact, you've got four.
Sure. Let me begin in reverse order. So Afghanistan is going to provide a platform for cooperation. Neutrality is a term from 1950s. Does it still really have application to 2014? So I think you should take the question back in terms of deliberation, because it's a different word. We are in an intersecting point. We want to make sure we are not a battlefield and we are not indifferent. We are dying on a daily basis. You think that is from neutrality? We need to make sure that the world becomes whole. Our interconnected world is not into spheres of neutral or left or right, or red or green. It is an integrated approach that is required to our interconnected world. We are very strong advocates of a regional compact on peace, on stability and prosperity. And our position as the intersection point of Asia forces us to think through. And the intersection of the negative side, the soft belly of globalization, again forces us to have alliances in these, or to protect our people and to protect your people and the world. So it's a new context, and in this context, we want to make sure, one, that our territory is not used against any of our neighbors, and I can assure you that it would not. But second, we're not going to permit anybody to use our territories as a ground for proxy battles. We are not the playing field of anyone. We've earned the right to peace, and we are going to ensure that no one looks at us as a playing field for any of their ideas and negative ideas. Positively, we are ground for cooperation, and that I think we will ensure. Secondly, prosecution of high-ranking officials. It depends on people bringing. We've just passed the law on public information. Citizens' movements have the right to take people to court. But let's understand the critical issue. The critical issue is carving a future with accountability, not going to the 35 years of the past. Reformists who have gotten the balance wrong between transformation and continuity have brought the whole house down. I do not want to engage in the Lenin tango, one step forward, three steps backward. We are going to be determined, every member of the new government from day one are going to disclose our assets, be accountable, update them, and make sure. The process of reckoning with the past is part of building the rule of law, and that's what we are steadily focusing. But don't ask me to deliver miracles on a single day. We need to maintain our focus and ensure that we move forward. Narcotics. Narcotics has three components: consumers, transitors, and producers, and processors. Yes, we acknowledge we are the largest producer and processor. Who in the room will raise their hands as to where are the largest consumers? The price of an ounce is $1.10. In Afghanistan, $1.15. In Iran, $42 in London. $46 around that in Amsterdam. These are global chains. Let us deal with the issue together. We need an alliance without blame games. If there is a will in the consumer countries to legalize drug, we have no comparative advantage. Any hothouse will grow it. If there is not that political will, then let us come to solve the problems together. Where is the solution? The key to the solution is transformation of Afghanistan's agriculture. Drug dealers pay $17 a day for labor, unskilled labor. The largest public program pays $2 a day. Where do you think unemployed people make the choice? We need, in theory, we have access to the markets of advanced industrial countries. In practice, we don't, because we don't have the knowledge, the value chain. Who can help us most? Tesco, Walmart, the consortium of supermarket chains that know how to organize supply and demand. The other is we are looking very much forward to persuading Saudi Arabia, United Arab Emirates, and others to link their food security with investment, long-term investment in our agriculture. Because that transformation is fundamental. Without this, in the history of drug eradication in Thailand and others, should be an example. Where do we differ? One area where we differ fundamentally is in the focus on the economy. Because in on regional economic integration, and that our worthy president, President Karzai, whom I still call my president, took responsibility under very, very difficult set of circumstances. There was no paradigm for him or for the world after the tragedy of 9/11. He did what he could. It's a difficult balancing act. The judgment needs to be made by history. But he is going to earn a place in history by being the first person in our 5,000 years of recorded craftsmanship to have transferred authority according to the rule of law to his elected successor. For that, he deserves praise and appreciation, and we want to make sure that that space is created. Our programs contrast, and I will be taking a direct managerial role in economic issue and issues of regional integration, for which I've spent a lifetime preparing, and I hope the results will speak for it.
Thank you. Right, let's take a few more. The gentleman with the white shirt, the lady beside him, and then I'll come over here. Please, go ahead.
Hi, good evening, President Ghani. I'm Fazan Arshad. I'm a medical student at Imperial College. I wanted to ask, how great of a barrier or facilitator do you see Pakistan as in the future political and economic development of Afghanistan?
Thank you. That was a very succinct question. I'd be grateful if others could be equally succinct.
Good evening. Heather Barr from Human Rights Watch. We haven't talked about human rights this evening, so I have two very quick questions.
Sure.
One is, I'm wondering when we can look forward to seeing the release of the Human Rights Commission's mapping report. And the second question is, I'm wondering if you'll order prosecutions of government officials who've engaged in the systematic and widespread torture that the United Nations has documented.
Thank you. Gentlemen, there was a gentleman here with a yellow tie in the middle.
John Wilson, a member of Chatham House. Mr. President, can you tell us your plans for the future emancipation of women in Afghanistan?
Okay, and one more. Unfortunately, we've just heard word that the Secretary of State, you have to leave in 5 minutes. So one more, and then,
In
7:28, I've been given the message. Okay, well, Mr. President, why don't you just deal with those one then?
Yeah.
Those three questions. It's Pakistan, human rights, and
sure.
The last one.
Pakistan and Afghanistan are facing an historical choice together. Do we become the cul-de-sac that stops Asia's economic integration, or do we become the linchpin of this economic integration? We are vital to each other. The dialogue we've started is promising. We're cautiously optimistic. And it is essential both to our mutual security, to Asia's future, and to global security that we share a common understanding of the problem and reach common solutions. The Human Rights Commission can release its report. It does not depend on me. They are an independent commission. And I've said that I've had a commitment during the campaign, which we'll honor, that we would like our human rights record every year to be evaluated by the Human Rights Commission. We will take their findings very seriously and act on it. Prosecution is up to the court system, not up to the government. Current law is clear, the law that Parliament had passed, Parliament would have to change the law for that. But individuals, as individuals, are free to bring cases. Muslim law makes a very clear distinction between the right of God and the right of man. The right of God can be forgiven by the state. The right of man can never be, or right of person, because Islam is not sexist, actually. It's a human being, which translates literally men or women. And that is always a retained right that no one can take away. And the Constitution guarantees that. Women, absolutely central. Thank you for that question. In terms of legal issues, because I need to leave, otherwise I'd love to take 10 minutes to describe that. A number of documents are critical to establishing the legal personality of the woman. Birth record, marriage record, divorce, when they are divorced, because now there are frequency, and inheritance. We want to make sure legal personality established, because this is the base of the legal rights. Second, of course, is that the court system, and I'm honored here that our acting Chief Justice is with us, Mr. Rashid, a man known for his integrity and judgment, and it was, again, one of my first acts. It's going to fall to me to appoint 2 judges of the Supreme Court this year and 3 next year. That is a phenomenal responsibility. We are going to interview dozens of judges to arrive at this in reform of the Supreme Court and the court system. The prosecutors, the Attorney General's office is critical. Rule of law is the fundamental part of empowerment of the women. So the rights that they have, both under Sharia and under civil law or in criminal law, or accorded to them. But what is really fundamental is economic empowerment of the world. And here, my request to all the international community, please stop two-day training courses. Let us, you know, what I asked the French foreign minister yesterday, I'm extending to all of you. If you really want to help our women, get the designers in London, Frankfurt, Paris, New York, and Tokyo together to design a made by Afghan woman label, open up your department stores to our women's products. And give us real credit, not microcredit, for women's entrepreneurship. Let's think grand scale. The West loves to talk about the rights of women. Could you match it, please, with some practice with us? We are willing. Would you partner so that we get real empowerment of the women? You know, the image of the empowered woman is that of my grandmother. She had six sons, and none of them dared call the couple of thousand acres of land that she had had in her own right and from her husband ever. She's been dead for 40 years. They're still not dividing it, still called real estate. And the reason was twofold. One, she was educated. She had been educated in exile in India of then and returned. Two, she had property. Without the economic basis, the legal rights do not translate. And it is fundamentally important to get that part. And a lot of violence against women, unfortunately, is on economic grounds. Poverty breeds violence. So we need to tackle this. And urban women, particularly poor urban women, are the most vulnerable. Because poor rural women at least have access to food. Unequal, because they are the agents. And the last issue is cultural change. Women, consciously, it's been studied across South Asia. Wherever the system of inheritance is paternal, women enforce patriarchy. And in the sense that they prefer their male sons to eat first, because ultimately their protection in old age depends on males. And this is a fundamental shift so that they can see East Asia has changed this in major ways, where the earnings of women have changed the dynamic, and we hope that we'd engage with this. But this is the toughest of the nuts to crack because it's the oldest division in humanity. So it cuts across, rich, poor, up, down, south, north, west. But we're very keen, and I'm always inspired by my grandmother.
Mr. President, I am delighted that your passion for empowerment of women has made you late.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.